Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, can you hear me? All right. Good evening. It's a great pleasure to see everyone here tonight, and I want to welcome you to the Brooks Library Latino American Culture Series. My name is Pat Swinney, and I'm the grant writer at Brooks Library, and I wrote the grant that made tonight's program possible. It's called the Latino American 500 Years of History Grant, and it's funded by the National Endowment for the Humanities and the American Library Association. I am personally proud to present this evening's performers, as I've known John Chmaj and the Cascade Jazz Ensemble for over two decades. They are one of the finest jazz ensembles on Seattle's east side. Several of their musicians have entered Central's jazz program, including Ryan McKnight, a current CWU's jazz student, who you'll hear play tonight. Tonight's ensemble unites Cascade Jazz with several top Central jazz students and other special Laz Chatton artists, giving the students a chance to perform in a personal, professional context and for you to experience the vibrant rhythms and innovative styles of Latino music. I'd like to again thank and acknowledge the National Endowment for the Humanities, American Library Association, and Brooks Library for their support in making this event possible. And also, a special thank you to Alan Larson and the staff of the CWU audiovisual team and Cascade Jazz and the guest artists who have worked very many weeks and to prepare for this living musical history for you tonight. So please welcome the Cascade Latin Jazz Ensemble.
Thanks, guys, and thanks, Pat. Welcome, everybody. Buenas noches.
Buenas noches.
Welcome to our presentation of the history of Latin jazz. I'm John Chmaj, the head of the Cascade Jazz Ensemble, and your guide on the history of Latin jazz for this evening. We're actually about to embark together on a journey of discovery, of union and evolution between three major cultural trends: the Spanish and Afro-Cuban world of South America, the popular songs and dances of North America, and the African-American rhythms that infused and ultimately bonded these influences together. For Latin jazz, it's more than just a set of songs or rhythms. It's the expression of the evolution of our culture in both North and South America as experienced through music and dance. It's the celebration of the unique synthesis of peoples that happens in our country naturally and almost inevitably when we sing, dance, and grow together. Latin musical influences flowed up, like many things, into the U.S. from Cuba, Haiti, and other countries into New Orleans, up from the Caribbean. As early as the 1800s, they were known as danzón bands, playing distinctly Caribbean music coming out of Cuba, Haiti, and other countries. As jazz music began in the early 1900s in New Orleans, earliest jazz composers, such as Jelly Roll Morton, were referring to the Spanish tinge inherent in jazz itself. So Latin American music is present at the very beginning of jazz and is part of the first music that was actually heard as jazz in the 1900s. Morton even went so far as to say, "If you can't manage to put tinges of Spanish in your tunes, you'll never be able to get the right seasoning, as I call it, for jazz." So the important thing to point out is that Afro-Cuban and Afro-American music were united from the very outset of the jazz experience. In fact, the earliest recorded blues, the first blues, the St. Louis blues, has a tango in it, based on a Cuban dance known as the habanero, or contradanza. So we're going to play St. Louis blues for you. The composer's name was W.C. Handy. He wrote this in 1914. And in writing about it, he said, "When St. Louis blues was written, the tango was in vogue. I tricked the dancers by arranging a tango introduction, breaking abruptly into a low-down blues. My eyes swept the floor anxiously. Then suddenly I saw lightning strike. The dancers seemed electrified. Something within them suddenly came to life. An instinct that so wanted to live, to fling its arms to spread joy, took them by the heels." So those of you who are not bilingual will just have to use your imagination, and when you spread your arms with joy, you'll know you're there. So we're going to go 1914, St. Louis Blues.
Thank you.
So when the rumba first came to the U.S., it came from dance bands in Cuba. And it came a hugely popular phenomenon in the 30s. And all kinds of musicians were doing the rumba, and the jazz musicians were no exception. Louis Armstrong had the Peanut Vendor song, and Duke Ellington jumped on board to ride that wave. Duke hired a trombonist from Puerto Rico named Juan Tizol into his band in 1929. Juan stayed for 15 years. And he brought a Puerto Rican influence from Latin America into the band. Right away, he started to change the sound. And in 1932, the two of them collaborated on the now classic Caravan. Now, Caravan was marketed as a Middle Eastern tune, and you can hear kind of the Middle Eastern sound in the melody. But the fact is, the whole tune sits on top of a Cuban rumba. So I don't know how many caravans they have in Cuba, but apparently they have at least one. So it's called Caravan, but it's a rumba song. And at this point, Latin rhythms were still an auxiliary part of jazz. In other words, they were the spice in the stew. You kind of added them in a little bit for flavor. They weren't really at the heart of a new Latin jazz music in the early 30s. Caravan has become a staple, nonetheless, in the jazz repertoire and has been widely recorded. We'll present it now featuring Henry Sparks, our trombonist. Let's climb aboard the Caravan.
Thank you.
Ernesto Padiangco on percussion. We've all heard of the bolero from the great music of Maurice Ravel. But the bolero is a slow Latin dance style with a long lineage starting in Spain and running back to America through Cuba and Mexico. This elegant slow style is used by many dancers still today, and it serves as the background to the most sung and recorded song in Mexican history, Bésame Mucho, means kiss me a lot. This classic was first recorded in 1940 and has served as a major pop, jazz, Latin crossover tune, highlighting another subgenre of Latin jazz as a highly popular dance and song style, not just an instrumental genre. Bésame Mucho has been recorded by everyone from Placido Domingo to the Beatles, and from Herb Adler to Michael Bublé. The composer, Consuelo Velasquez, wrote Bésame Mucho even though she says she had never been kissed, but she said, I can imagine what it must feel like. So we think she had an active imagination, and we hope you do too, as we'll hear Susanna Fuller sing the original Spanish lyrics to Bésame Mucho. Those of you who are bilingual, or not bilingual rather, will have to use your imagination as to just when all this kissing takes place. Well, Latin jazz truly became a music in its own right in New York City in the 1930s and the 40s. Afro-Cuban music, also known as Cubop at that time, began to take place with the rise of the Latin big bands of Machito and Mario Bauza, great Latin bands that took New York by storm and owned the nightclubs. There was a whole evening you could spend at multiple clubs doing Cuban and Afro-Latin dancing alongside of jazz. Well, after their respective performances in these clubs, the jazz musicians would get together in downtown Manhattan and elsewhere in New York City and jam and share ideas. And before you know it, they really had created music that was a combination of everything they knew at once. And then these Latin jazz things began to synthesize into a new style. And there was a tune called Tanga, written in 1943, that was considered to be the first true Latin jazz piece of music that was neither jazz nor Latin on top, but a synthesis of the two. And it was a new sound never before heard. Hearing tanga for the first time may be a little disorienting for jazz listeners. We're used to hearing, you know, they're gonna play the melody, then there'll be some solos, like we did here, and then the melody. That's not the case in Afro-Latin music. People come in and out the door, they're jamming, they go take a break, they go out and have a drink, they come back. The music is just ongoing and flowing. And so it's got all this layers to it that goes on. And that's what they recorded in tanga. They recorded those layers. It's more like a jam session. The layers of horns float in and out, and the underlying mambo beat is really what holds it all together. So Machito's band brought Latin jazz to the attention of every major jazz figure in New York. Stan Kenton, Dizzy Gillespie, Duke, and all these people were coming in to hear Machito and trying to understand what he was doing. And Machito told them what he was doing in tanga. We're gonna hear that first Latin jazz tune, Tanga. Thank you. 1943, still sounds hip. That was the first album that was on a 45. You youngins don't know what a 45 was. It came right before the 46. an album that was about this big, which you put on, you know, a little record player, and it was about 3 minutes long. And they made the first recording 6 minutes. So you had to turn the record over in the middle of Flip Phillips' solo to listen to the sax solo. It was unlike anything anybody had ever heard. It was a huge hit, the biggest hit of its day for that kind of music. Tanga. Now, obviously, this is starting to really take shape in New York City. And Dizzy Gillespie, one of the forerunners of bebop and modern jazz, he actually was one of the original jazz Latin players as well. He and Mauro Bauza, the composer of what we just heard, both played in Cab Calloway's band when Dizzy was first coming up in the 30s. He was exposed to all the Latin jazz figures in New York, hung out with them all the time, and as he evolved his bebop style with Charlie Parker, he almost immediately started including Latin rhythms into his music. One of his most famous compositions is called The Night in Tunisia, and as Art Blakey's fond of reminding folks, it was composed on the top of a garbage can back of a nightclub in 1942. It was a famous tune. It was one of the most unique of the early bebop tunes, because instead of just sort of swinging along, it had this Latin mambo thing going, and it's a mix of Latin and swing with an unusual minor riff for a melody. And so it was rather unusual that way, and it had a solo break, which could make you or break you, depending on how good your chops were. So we're going to give it an exciting drive here with our alto sax duo of Adam Chmaj and Ryan McKnight. They're going to go at it now in one of the all-time bebop Latin classics, A Night in Tunisia. Thank you. Brian McKnight and Schmay on saxophone. All right. One of these students is not a CWU student. That's my son, 16-year-old Adam Schmay from high school over here on saxophone. Get after it. He and Ryan met here at Central Jazz Camp, a year ago? Central Jazz Camp, and I had a great time playing up here on the stage. Little did we know we'd all be standing up here a year later having a blast. The next tune we're going to play is another Dizzy Gillespie tune that was really, really well known and really popular, Manteca. And as Dizzy's interest in Latin music grew, he sought out the best Latin players to give spice to his bands. And he went down to Cuba and found one of the best conga drummers in the whole world, really. John Oposo. Yeah, that was not you, no. Ernesto, you were around back in 1947, says here. Okay.
Warmer life.
Okay. A little bit younger. Slightly younger. John Oposo would dazzle audiences with his intense conga solos, and he provided the entire Dizzy Gillespie band with a new identity. The whole band was transformed by his conga playing. Bassist Al McKibben, a major jazz contributor to this Latin synthesis, he writes, "When we started to play things with a Latin flavor in Dizzy's band, some kind of magic happened. Tunes like Night in Tunisia, they were marvelous with the conga drum. And when we played Manteca at the Apollo Theater, I thought the balcony was going to fall off the hinges. Chano Pozo was so great." In 1947, Pozo and Gillespie wrote Manteca, a huge hit for the band and the best fusion of jazz and Afro-Cuban music to this point. By the late 1940s, bebop and Latin music became merged at clubs and dance halls throughout New York. Imagine going into a dance club, hearing a kicking Latin band for a set, then Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie for a set, then they all come together and play. It must have been a heck of a night. That's what was happening. Latin jazz was here to stay. Manteca! artists starting to embrace jazz and Latin music, and bop artists such as Sonny Rollins and Horace Silver and a lot of other great artists in the 50s created a lot of different jazz Latin compositions. On the cool side, there was a whole new generation of music coming through George Shearing, Cal Jader, and a lot of the other cool jazz musicians started to create another whole cool Latin jazz with performances that had gentle lyricism and simplicity that added the percussive rhythm underneath. At the same time that Latin jazz musicians enjoyed their greatest popularity, there was a lot of mambo and dance music happening in the 50s, and they began to perform in Havana as well as New York. So jazz Latin music went down into Cuba, and in Havana began to be called the jazz bands. And what we don't remember today is before 1960, Cuba was a hip place to go. You went on vacation to Cuba. You went to Havana to hang out, just like you might go to Miami or the Virgin Islands today. So people were going down there and jamming in Cuba, and now there's a whole bunch of stuff happening at once. So by the early 60s, Latin jazz was a mature art form with 50 years of history behind it already. And it was time for more countries to start contributing to that mix. And one of the sounds that you're all familiar with that began at this time was the bossa nova and the samba from South America, from Brazil, and many of the artists that began to influence each other. And some of the jazz musicians like Dizzy Gillespie and Herbie Mann went down to Brazil and got their minds blown and came back up with a whole bunch of Brazilian musicians. And before you know it, there was this whole bossa nova craze. And bossa and samba have a different approach. It's much gentler, it's more lyrical and simple, and it has great melodies and clear harmonies. Now at the center of this thing in the early 60s was a composer named Antonio Carlos Jobim. And he's written a lot of songs that many of you know because they've just been around for 50 years now. They're just part of the standard repertoire for jazz. And his tunes serve as the fuel for many jazz musicians to reinvent themselves. And one of the main musicians that really benefited from this was Stan Getz, who just reinvented the bossa nova jazz sax style almost on his own and really became a major jazz performer. Now we're going to end our first set with a couple of beautiful bossa samba tunes. We're going to feature our vocalist Jan Jaffe to sing these lovely tunes for you. And the first one is one of the most popular tunes. If you haven't heard it, you've never been in an elevator or the dentist's office. This is The Girl from Ipanema, and you're going to dig it. It's still a fantastic, well-constructed song and has legs today. And then we're going to perform another song that was really made famous by Gilberto and his wife, Astrid Gilberto. But it actually was from the musical State Fair in 1945, sung by Gene Crane. So it proves that almost any music, when applied to the Latin beat, can suddenly become something unique and interesting. So here is The Girl, or Boy, from Ipanema. Thank you. Ensemble of Washington students.
This handsome man is John Chmaj. I don't know if he introduced himself. John Chmaj.
All right. Get yourself a glass of water. There's some goodies right outside. And we'll see you at 10.